this lecture, we focus on how to enhance natural ventilation by adopting some techniques or by providing some devices. First of all, when designing so as to profit as much as possible from the benefits of natural ventilation, both cross and stack, organization of the rooms plays an important role. There are cases in which it is difficult to provide adequate ventilation, even if the location is fairly windy. A first one is the case in low-rise, high-density settlements, where it is difficult to get good wind access because upwind buildings block breezes. A second situation occurs when conflict between the best orientation for shade and wind forces some protection to be favored. Also, it may happen that the shape of the plot does not allow the building to be oriented to take advantage of the prevailing wind directions. In some countries, a traditional solution to this kind of problem is the windcatcher, a tower capable of capturing winds above the building, bringing in fresh air from outside. A prerequisite for using a windcatcher is that the site should experience winds with fairly good consistent speed. Windcatchers can be categorized in two groups, vernacular windcatcher and modern or commercial ones. The foundation of these types of windcatchers is almost the same. Windcatcher inlets, in order to rise above the layer of turbulence and drag, should be at least 2.4 meters above the height of the surrounding buildings and obstructions. When designing a new building, the size of the windcatcher opening required to achieve a given airflow rate can be determined from a graph as a percentage of floor area. As we can see here, one can enter the design wind speed on the vertical axis of the graph, move horizontally until the curve of the required ventilation airflow rate is intercepted, then drop to the horizontal axis to read the size of inlet as a percentage of floor area. The graph is based on an incident wind angle of between 0, normal, and 40 degrees to the windcatcher opening. For windcatcher designs with openings in multiple directions, the openings in each direction should be sized to meet the airflow rate required. The inlet from a single direction should be no larger than the cross-sectional area of the tower, while operable windows used for outlet should be about twice as large as the inlets. Induced ventilation can be very effective in hot and humid climates, as well as in hot and dry climates. Ventilation can be induced in three ways. One way involves heating air in a restricted area through solar radiation, thus creating a temperature difference and causing air movements, as in solar chimneys. The draft causes a hot air to rise and escape outdoors, drawing in cooler air and thereby causing cooling. The second way exploits wind velocity either by channeling the airflow inside or by creating depression with a rotating device moved by wind to extract air from the building. The third way exploits the Venturi effect, where air is extracted from the building because of the low pressure created by the wind on top of a shaft. In windy areas, it could be an effective alternative to windcatchers. At this point, let's summarize some recommendations for best exploiting natural ventilation. The building should be oriented to maximize surface exposure to prevailing winds. However, a building does not necessarily need to be oriented perpendicular to the prevailing wind. It may be oriented to any convenient angle between 0 and 30 degrees without losing any beneficial aspects of the breeze. In the orientation of the building and in sizing the windows, the different needs according to the climate have to be considered. Day ventilation in a hot humid climate, night ventilation in a hot arid climate with significant daily temperature variation, moderate ventilation in a cool upland climate. Rising the building on stilts is an advantage, it catches more wind. Hedges and shrubs deflect air away from the inlet openings and cause a reduction in the air motion. These should not be planted inside a distance of about 8 meters from the building because the induced air motion is reduced to a minimum in that case. However, air motion in the leeward part of the building can be enhanced by planting low hedges at a distance of 2 meters from the building. Trees with larger foliage mass with trunks bare of branches up to the top the level of the window deflect the outdoor wind downwards and promote air motion in the leeward portion of the buildings. An effective cross-ventilation design must consider a limitation of the depth of the building to facilitate inward airflow from one facade and outward flow from the other. Architectural elements can be used to harness prevailing winds. Architectural features like wing walls, parapets, can be used to create positive and negative pressure areas to induce cross-ventilation. Since air speed inside the space varies significantly depending on the location of openings, the most effective strategy is to provide staggered openings on opposite walls. Room widths should be limited if openings cannot be provided in two walls. Large openings, door and windows are an advantage if they are effectively protected from the penetration of solar radiation. Inlet and outlet openings at a high level would only clear the air at that level without producing any air movement at the level of the occupancy. Maximum air movement at a particular plane is achieved by keeping the sill height of the opening at 85% of the critical height, such as at the level. Greatest flow per unit area of openings is obtained by using inlet and outlet openings of nearly equal areas at the same level. In rooms of normal size which have identical windows on opposite walls, the average indoor airspeed rises rapidly by increasing the width of the window by up 2/3 of the wall width. Beyond that, the increase in indoor airspeed is less effective. In the case of rooms with only one wall exposed to outside, provision of two windows on that wall is preferred to a single window. A single side window opening can ventilate a space up to a depth of 6-7 meters. With cross ventilation, a depth up to 15 meters may be naturally ventilated. Integration with atrium or chimney to increase the stack effect can also ventilate deeper plant spaces.